My pleasure to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Shira Feigenbaum-Golovin. Shira is a Phillip Griffiths Assistant Research Professor at Duke University, working with Professor Ingrid Dobushi. On top of her research of mathematical approximation tools for manifolds embedded in high dimensions, she's an expert of machine learning and image processing algorithms applied to archaeological and paleography. Today, Shira will present a research on computerized paleographic investigation of Hebrew First Temple period Ostraca. So please, Shira, the stage is yours.
It's my pleasure to be here. Do you see my presentation now?
Yes.
Okay. So as I was already introduced, my name is Shira Feigenbaum-Golovin. Today I'm at Duke University and doing my postdoc studies, and previously, but I will talk today about the research that I performed in Tel Aviv University. So it was not only me that participated in this research. There are many people. I should introduce them also. So when we started, we were three enthusiastic master students, Barak Sover, Aryeh Shaus, and myself, under the supervision of Israel Finkelstein from archaeology and Eli Pisetskin from physics department. We were actually applied mathematics that wanted to change the field of archaeology. And looking back, I think that we did some change in it, and today I will describe our research. Along the way, we had many collaborations and also some other people that joined us. So we had Eitan Levy from the archaeology department, and also Orda Lal from the engineering. We had collaborations with the different archaeologists and historical experts. And we had also our supervisors from the exact science, Eli Turkel, David Levine, Muri Moinster, and Nachum Darshowitz. So that was the group in there. It's a glory time. So this is a brief overview of the work that we did during our 10 years of work. So we started with doing multispectral imaging, and we are talking the material that we were in dealing with is in Ostraca, which is clay pieces where someone wrote them with ink. And those Ostraca, as I'll short describe, are pertaining to 600 BC or 800 BC, and they were found in Israel in many locations. And this is the material that we dealt with. So it's ancient writing, and they're hardly visible, and therefore there were many challenges. So in order to overcome those challenges, first we developed some method and low-cost system how to image those shards. Later, we developed some kind of protocol how to look for them on the field, because many shards are just thrown away just because they are not visible, the ink is not visible enough. We did some small project of identifying what was the ink consists of, what are the particles, the chemical particles, and also some Raman spectroscopy to identify the location of the ink. Later, we did a lot of automatic and semi-automatic binarizations, meaning we created automatic facsimiles of the texts, and also created paleographical tables which describe the variability of the text that we had. And one of our biggest projects was to develop a method for handwriting comparison, and in order to identify the number of writers in certain corpuses, and I will describe this in details shortly. And last but not least, we had an interesting collaboration with the forensics department at the Israel police office, where we asked the forensic expert to look for different writers manually in the ancient writers in ancient documents that we had. And there was a very interesting outcome for both of the sides. So let's start to dip in those topics. You can stop me at any time, so don't hesitate to ask questions. So we're talking about First Temple period. Just go back in time. We're talking about the period of just before the destruction in 587 BCE by Nebuchadnezzar of Judah. And we are talking about also about the Israel kingdom. We're not talking about what came later, the Qumran scrolls or Dead Sea scrolls. We're in the period of Ostraca. And those only texts actually survived till our days from that period. So how many texts do we have? We have some 190 texts from Samaria. This is the capital of Israel. We have 35 texts from Lachish, 112 from Arad. This is a fort in the desert. We have 17 from Uzzah, and maybe three, four here, and some more there, but no more sufficient corpus exist. So therefore, we couldn't really apply deep learning methods to those texts, and we had to develop some some classical methods, statistical and machine learning, in order to overcome and answer the questions that paleographer asks. So today I'll talk about two sites. One is the Arad site, which is a fort located in the middle of the desert, the Judah desert, in the middle of nowhere, where a huge corpus of inscriptions was found. And they are dating to 600 BCE. And this is some example of this corpus. You see that some of them are very nice, some of them are less nice and illegible and broken. And we are also talking about the Samaria site, which is kingdom of Israel in the 8th century, and have some huge corpus also there. So basically those two corpora that I'll describe to you today, we deal with them. So first of all, we decided to perform data collection, because when we started, no data was available in terms of digital data. There were films and glass negatives, so we started collecting them and imaging them. Later, we restored the characters of those inscriptions in order to come to our big question, how to compare two texts, whether they are written by the same or not. And this is what I call the hypothesis testing. We have some statistical method in order to do this. So first of all, in data collection. So we had some glass negatives that were in the basement of the Israel Museum and in the basement of Harvard Semitic Museum. So we traveled long and nearby to collect the data and scan those negatives, but they were not enough, because we decided to do also multispectral imaging. Multispectral imaging, just in two words, it's instead of having a color image, we have a lot of wavelengths that we image with, and each wavelength have some information corresponding to some wavelength range. And maybe it contains other information that's visible by the human eye. So it's known from the Dead Sea Scrolls or from art that at times multispectral imaging assists in finding additional information. So we wanted to formulate a procedure just for the Ostraca case. So we borrowed a fancy camera and started imaging Ostraca. We imaged 33 Ostraca from the whole corpus. And after analyzing the results of where the ostraca behaves better, we were able to formulate a low-cost system instead of $100K dollars system that this one cost. We have now a 5K system in our lab, which provides a comparable results with only two filters instead of 50 filters. So from now on, we started imaging with this camera. We had many successes. One of the most notable is the Arad 16 ostraca, which was known to be written on one side, but on the other side, as you can see, or can see that there is nothing seen now via visible light. Using the multispectral imaging, we found three lines of text. That was amazing, seeing after so many years these lines suddenly appear in front of you and you can read them. That was a really amazing thing. And this what brought us to think that many ostraca that are found in this condition on site probably will be thrown away and never get to the laboratory for imaging. That's why we have now an imaging procedure for imaging ostraca on site, what we call the hunting the ostraca. Once we have a database of those ostraca, we can think about creating facsimiles or binarizations to those ostraca. So we tried out of the box methods, but they didn't work because of the noise present in those texts and because of many other things. So we had to develop a new method, our own, that was semi-manual. So the semi-manual is based on the user marks and the beginning and the end of the stroke. And we found the best optimal stroke that reconstruct the movement of the paint of the writer by looking for several criteria. So first of all, we are looking for a reconstruction that will be adherent to what is visible. And in the invisible parts, we are looking for some from reconstruction that will not change the pen of the radius of the pen a lot, and will maintain the curvature of the stroke. In this manner, we were able to reconstruct two corpora. So here's an example of the reconstruction. We start with linear reconstruction, just connecting line and proceed with more adherent reconstruction and only also this data. So we reconstructed the Arad corpus and the Samaria, sorry. And later we extracted the features that are usually used in the computer vision to compare different objects. So we had seven different features that somehow comprise the angle between the strokes of the writing, the shape of the letters, and so on and so forth. And we can now measure the distance between two letters using those features. Now that we have this embedding from the letter space to the feature space, we can actually ask the question whether the two inscriptions were written by different authors or not. So in statistics, it's easier to negate a hypothesis than prove one. So the H-naught hypothesis was that both texts were written by the same author, and we tried to reach some proofs that this was not true. We had some mechanism that I will describe in a minute, that either it negates the hypothesis and then we conclude that they were indeed written by two different authors, or in the other case, we remain agnostic. We can't say that they were written by the same author because this is how statistics works. But we are quite happy with this as well. So a short explanation how this method works of handwriting comparison. So we have an inscription A and we have an inscription B, and we have the Hebrew letter Aleph that was written either in the inscriptions. We throw them in one pile, and using the features that we extracted before, we perform automatic clustering of the inscriptions. Now that we have them clustered, we look on of their origin of those letters, and we see how uniform is each inscription in terms of the letters that it has. So for example, if a letter, writer A was quite uniform in his writing, and writer B was quite uniform as well, then the letters will be quite distinct by the geometric characteristics, and we're able to separate them perfectly. But if there were some kind of confusion, or if it was one writer that wrote those inscriptions, we will not be able to distinguish between the letters, and we will say that we remain agnostic in our hypothesis test. So eventually, after doing this statistical test, we get what we call p-value. It's some probability or the likelihood that two inscriptions were written by a single author or not. So we can calculate this likelihood, the similarity likelihood for one letter, for two letters, and many more. We had actually reconstructed for the Arad case, seven letters that we applied this comparison, and eventually we combined these p-values to a single p-value. And we tested our methodology on the modern writing, and we got quite good results of 2.6 false negatives identification and 4.7 false positive. And we were quite happy because other methods that we tried to apply reached much, much, much lower results than what we had. So we decided to apply it to the real case, the Arad case. So as I said, it's a fort in the middle of nowhere. Probably 20, 30 soldiers were sitting in this fort, and there was this guy, which his name was Eliashiv, that was the quartermaster of this fort, who gave provision to the ones that came to this fort and that were traveling near the desert. And this fort is important to understand the literacy in Judah at the time at 600 BCE. Because of the archive that was found in it, about 100 letters, which were sent to this fort, and some of the letters were written in this fort itself. So we took 18 texts, and we applied our methodology, meaning we performed pairwise comparison of each text versus each text. And we got this scary table, where each line corresponds to a specific text that we compared against all the other texts in the corpus. And we colored the cells that are less than a certain p-value that was a priori selected, 0.1. And we see that the red ones are that we get a separation. So for example, inscription number one is separated from inscription number 18. It's also separated from inscription number 24. And we can analyze this connection and find how many different writers were in this corpus. So actually we found two groups of such separate writings. Each time we had five separate writing each group, meaning at least five writers wrote these 18 inscriptions. And having this observation by chance is very has meant very low probability, as you can see here. We calculated, so we didn't just get this result. It has some meaning. So now we go back and try to reconstruct who were the writers. So the first one is written from the king of Judah. His assistant writes the letter. It's later we can see. Also Malkiyahu, the commander of the Arad fort. We can also see the Eliashiv, that he was the quartermaster responsible for the provision. He was also present in answering those letters. We see also the subordinate of this Eliashiv. So this is the subordinate of the quartermaster of this fort in the middle of the desert that also knew how to read and write. He writes to Eliashiv, my master. And we see that along the chain of command, the Judah chain of command, everyone knew how to read and write. And then this brought us to think that probably there was some kind of school of writing for each one that attended the army. And then this was published in PNAS. It hit at the New York Times in 2016. And this was a big issue then. And why is it so important? Because now we see that at Judah, 600 BCE, people knew how to read and write. They had some infrastructure. And this is closely related to when was the Bible composed, because if there were people that knew how to read and write, that not only the priests were standing in the gate of the city, reading everyone the Bible, But there were already people that were familiar with this medium, and therefore, probably there were several texts that were composed at that time. So we said, okay, we have a methodology, let's apply it for the Samaria case. This is the capital of the Northern Kingdom of Israel, and we'll have an easy life and we have a nice result as well. And the Samaria Ostraca is a very fascinating one, just a few words about them. They have some template, all the Ostraca that they found, that it mentions the year of a king. It doesn't mention what king, but it mentions that it's year 9, 10, or 15. There's some kind of toponym, name of the clan, and commodity that was sent to the Samaria, and some person name. And then we decided to compare those Ostraca. So we performed the same procedure. We collected the data, we extracted the characters, we constructed them, and performed the comparison. We got this crazy table again. And now we colored here in pink the ones that are separated by our 0.1 p-value threshold. And we see that we only get 10 separations. So we are not in the same situation as the Arad, where we have plenty of separations. Here we have only 10. And basically we see that in those 10 only we can identify identify at minimum two writers. So the question is, minimum two writers, this can be one, this can be two, maybe 10, maybe 30 writers. What is the real number then? So in order to identify this, we had to develop additional algorithm to deal with this task, because basically what you see in this table, that most of the table is sparse, that no comparison was performed. And this was basically because of the situation of the letters. As you can see here, the letters are quite small, and maybe there were not a significant amount of letters to perform the comparison. So do we trust these two writers? So we performed, this is short comparison of how the Arad corpus looks and how the Samaria, and you see actually the difference in the amount of writings. So we added additional method to evaluate the error of our separation. So we had an estimate of the same writer, what is the real error of this separation, and what is the error for the different writers. And based on different configurations, what we call different amount of letters in the comparison, we were able to find this error. So in order to do this, I hope I have several minutes more. It's okay?
Yes, fine.
Okay.
For 5 minutes more, yes, fine.
Okay, thanks. So then in order to identify this error, we took the Arad corpus that is most closer to the Samaria in terms of the letter, how they look like, and also the period, although they're 2,200 years apart, there's still more similarity than in modern writings. So we first simulated the scenario of whether we have an inscription that was written by two inscriptions were written by a single author, and what is the error of finding this separation. So we took the Arad inscriptions and we randomly divided them into two by the letters, and we performed the same experiment and found the false positive and false negative and true negative for this scenario. Later on, we took two different inscriptions that we knew from our Arad experiment already that they were separated, and we found the error for identifying or misidentifying the two writers in this case, the two positive and the false negative. And once we have the error for each configuration, we can ask ourselves, given the 10 separations that we see in the Samaria table, what is the number of the probable number of writers that could have written those 30 inscriptions in Samaria? So our test consisted of going through the number of writers that were in, that could have written this text in Samaria. And we asked whether if we have a single writer, what is the number of separation that we'll have? If we have two writers in Samaria, what is the probable number of writers that we have? If we have three writers and so on and so forth. And eventually we got those curves, each corresponding to a number of writers that could have written those inscriptions. And now we have this 10 separations in Samaria, and we look what is the highest probability that this number of writers wrote them. And we see that actually the curve of two has the highest probability for those 10 separations. So via evaluating the error of our framework, we found that it's mostly probable that two writers wrote those 30 ostraca in Samaria. So this has high implication for the entire historical reconstruction. First of all, we try to characterize them via some textual evidence, as we did in Arad. And as you saw, that there were many information in the ostraca themselves, the year of the king and the name and the clan, but we were not able to identify either one of the characteristics actually characterized those two writers. So we conclude that they were contemporaneous, working together, sitting probably in the gate or somewhere in this capital of the Israel kingdom. Probably they were located in Samaria and not traveling alone writing those texts. And this shows that at times of Samaria, we had a central administration only based on these writings. And we see that in the Samaria is a corpus that were written in 800 BC, while the Arad corpus was written in 600 BC. And we see the transition from two writers in the glory capital of Israel through the transition to at least five writers in the middle of the desert. And there were plenty more corpora that existed in Judah. And we see that suddenly there was some kind of explosion in the literacy from between these periods. So this is what we did in 10 years of our work. And if you want to learn more about it, you can find in my site, there's a link to the site of the computerized paleography, if you look just for nuclear ostraca, and then you can find more details about it. So that's about it. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Shira.